Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this festive edition of the Royal Berkshire Fire Authority. Just a reminder before we start that this is being recorded. Gentlemen, they're filming us, and the it will be made available on the on a YouTube channel after the event. But so thanks everybody for coming along. Elliot, are there any apologies for absence?
Yes, Chair, I've received apologies from councillors Tina McKenzie Boyle, Mike Smith and Colin Dudley.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Faith. Item two, are there any declarations of interest? Nobody's signalled, so there are none. And we have the minutes of the meeting held on the 4th of October. Are we happy to record those as a correct record of the meeting, which I can sign? Have we got a... I'm proposing that we record them. Any a seconder for the minutes? Councillor Shell. Shell, okay. Just sign these in due course. Thanks, members. Then receipt of... sorry, those in favour? Oh, sorry. Well, no, you Councillor Linden. Sorry, I apologise. I'm trying to race ahead because it's...
Yeah, I was just going to ask on page...
Okay, anybody want to respond to that? Sorry.
That's absolutely the intention to. I'm not entirely sure whether there's one in the calendar already. I suspect there might not be from what you've said. So we can double check that and get one in the new year.
Right. Well, thanks, Councillor Linda, for raising that. So all those in favour of adopting minutes as a correct record? It's unanimous to me. Thanks very much, members. Move on to the receipt of announcements, which first of all is from me, so I shall start. I mean, the first item to say is that the firefighters, and apologies for those who are managing committee, some of these will be a repetition of what you've heard, but obviously this is the full authority. So the firefighters pay offer has been rejected. The FBU announced the decision of its membership in line with its executive council recommendation to reject the offer of a pay increase of 5% effective from 1st of July 2022. The FBU has now started a ballot of its members seeking support for industrial action, which will run until Monday the 30th of January. While this ballot is carried out, Royal Berkshire Fire and Rescue Service continues to put arrangements in place to meet our legal duties under the 2004 Fire and Rescue Services Act to ensure, as far as possible, the safety and protection of the communities we serve. And I'll continue to keep you updated on any developments over the coming weeks. On Tuesday, the 1st of November, and many of you were there, the service's annual award ceremony took place at the Coppin Beach Hotel in Bracknell. It's a really excellent event. It was due to take place originally on the 10th of September at Welford Park. However, this was postponed due to the sad passing of Her Late Majesty the Queen. Awards were presented in 13 categories, followed by a Long Service Award and Long Service Good Conduct Medals for 20 years service. This year, three recipients also received a 30-year Long Service Good Conduct clasp to be worn on the ribbon of recipients' existing 20-year medals. And you can find more about the award winners and medal recipients on the Royal Berkshire website. And also, obviously, I'd like to take the time to congratulate them all on their achievements and also express my gratitude to the events team who worked so hard to make the event such a success. And it was a really great evening. We're currently running a public consultation on the members' code of conduct. Members may have seen that in communications with you. The code of conduct document outlines the standards and behaviours of elected councillors are required to adhere to on their appointment as fire authority members, and we sort of ask you to encourage others to take part by visiting the by the website, and there's a link to it. And the consultation is until 9 a.m. on Monday, the 9th of January. Some really great news here. The chairman's internship project has been recognised as a winner of the Positive Action Award at the Asian Fire Service Association AFSA Awards, which took place on the 23rd of November. The scheme was also shortlisted for Project of Year at the Excellence in Fire and Emergency Awards. And the project team worked to design and shape the internship from scratch, organising planned activities, hosting engagement days, advertising and carrying out numerous interviews and assessment centres. And members of the project team all brought their own knowledge and expertise to contribute to the scheme, making it what it is today. And I'd like to personally congratulate all those involved. I mean, it's thoroughly worthy of the award, and it's been recognised now, and rightly so. Finally, on a more sombre note, many of you will be aware of the publication of the Independent Culture Review of the London Fire Brigade by Nazir Afzal OBE, which has been widely reported in the media. The review contains distressing information about the culture and professionalism of fire and rescue service staff, and recommendations for improvement which have been accepted in full by the London Fire Brigade. While this review applies to London Fire Brigade, we recognise the sector-wide importance of the report. Therefore, in line with the National Fire Chiefs Council, we want to make it clear that there is no place for harassment, bullying or discrimination in the fire and rescue service, and I'm sure all members would, and all those present would agree with that. As a service, we've begun a thorough gap analysis of the recommendations contained within the report, which will be coordinated through the Equality, Diversity and Inclusion Forum. Wayne Bocock, Chief Fire Officer, has also written to all staff outlining his response to the report, and you did that very, very promptly, and I thank the Chief for doing that, and the approach that we'll take to ensure that we have a truly inclusive working environment in Royal Berkshire Fire and Rescue Service. So at that point, echoing those sentiments, I'm going to pass over to Wayne to say a few words as well to the Chief Fire Officer.
Thank you, Chair. So, as the Chair says, we've written to staff. We're also conducting a round of visits with staff that we do in general anyway, and making sure that we conduct open conversations about their understanding and encouraging them to have dialogue and debate in their teams to discuss both the report in its entirety, those that have read it, but also the content of the communication that was sent out from me. I said we'd conduct an initial gap analysis. That has very kindly and very promptly been done. I asked the initial person who was going to have a look at that gap analysis to be robust and to be as objective as possible. That individual, unfortunately, as an individual, I say unfortunately, she has moved on to bigger and better things in her career, so we've lost her. So it was her last action for us as she was leaving the organisation. So I think the degree of objectivity is probably enhanced, and I asked her to challenge us strongly when carrying out the gap analysis. She's presented me with an initial copy of that gap analysis. There were 23 recommendations in Nazir Afzal's report. Of those 23 recommendations, there are a small number of them that are difficult to align to organisations other than the London Fire Brigade, because they were specific to some of their procedures and processes. However, out of those 23, the gap analysis I have indicates that we have five areas that currently we feel are green. So we're making good progress in those areas, and we already have procedures, policies, processes in place. There are 12 areas that are amber, where some further action is or could be required, and the next step of the process is to assess that against our Equality, Diversity and Inclusion Action Plan. And there are 6 areas that have been identified as red, where we don't yet have a plan in place, and we will be working almost immediately to make sure that we take steps to move in the right direction. So bearing in mind this is an initial gap analysis, we have an EDI action plan consistent with the refreshed equality, diversity and inclusion objectives and our commitments as an organisation. We'll be taking this initial gap analysis to the Equality, Diversity and Inclusion Steering Group, where we'll be bringing that together with the EDI action plan that was already in place as a service, making sure we pick out any duplicated effort, but make a very clear plan of how we move forward, both the 23 recommendations in the Nazir AFSAR report, and also use that as a springboard to accelerate the progress within the EDI action plan that we already have. So we've moved quite quickly. Clearly more work to do. It's an initial gap analysis, but I thank Chloe, who's done the work for us, for giving us very early eyes on where we are so that we can move it through the arrangements we already have in place to complement the existing work. Chair.
Thank you. Thank you, Chief. And members, Councillor Linden.
Just quickly, how is the time frame for Chloe's replacement so we can carry on, or have you got a temporary arrangement, Chief?
Take that answer, Chair. It is in the plan, so she's part of Becky's team in HR, and Becky, are you already out or about to go out to advert for a replacement?
We'll be looking to do that in the new year.
Thanks. Thanks, Councillor Linden. No other members. Oh, Councillor Perner.
Yeah, obviously, the London report was hugely disappointing. I'd just like to say that I really appreciate the way that we're embracing the findings of that and really taking it seriously and not sort of pushing it into long grass, but actually dealing with it straight up. Well done.
Indeed. Any other members? So I think, you know, I think it is a credit that we are doing that, but obviously let nobody under any illusions that, you know, we're looking into this, and let's hope that we don't uncover anything untoward. But obviously in London it's a very serious situation, and we'll, you know, we keep across this and keep monitoring it. But thanks, members. Okay, we move on to item five, which is issues arising from the Audit and Governance Committee. There are none. See, item six, petitions and questions from the public.
None.
Item seven, questions from members, understanding Order 30. None received. Item eight, notice of motions, understanding Order 44.
None.
Thank you, Faith. Item eight, recommendations from committee, and there was no recommendations of committees, so thank you, members. We can move swiftly to item 10, which is substantive business of this evening's agenda, which is the Corporate Plan and Community Risk Management Plan, the CRMP. I'm the chair, and also I'm the lead member in this area, and I know that a lot of work has been going on behind the scenes to present this plan, and I thank in advance all those that were involved with this work, which, as you can see from your agenda pack, it's extremely comprehensive, 100 pages of very, very detailed information, and I think laid out excellently. But obviously we're going to hear later about that. I mean, the CRMP sets out the Fire Authority's plans for managing fire and rescue-related risks that could affect our communities here in Berkshire. The CRMP explains how we will reduce or manage these risks, either by changing the way we work, collaborating with other agency, or by building new capabilities. The plan details what we believe is the most significant risks posed to the people of Berkshire and provides a comprehensive overview of how we intend to manage them as a service. And this has been done in line with the requirements laid out for CRMPs in the Fire and Rescue Services National Framework for England. Our latest CRMP will cover a four-year period from 2023 to 2027 rather than the usual three-year span. As a service, we have opted to make this change as it better complements our medium-term financial plan and will allow us more time to address priority areas with the resources available to us. So I'm now going to invite Chief Wayne to briefly outline the change commitments in the new CRMP.
Thank you, Chair. So the latest corporate plan and community risk management plan is the services first since I assumed the role of Chief Fire Officer last year in 2021. A lot has changed over the last 3 years, both externally and probably internally in the organisation. And that is obviously locally within Berkshire and also beyond. So we feel that obviously the new community risk management plan needs to reflect those changes. The CRMP is built around a new set of commitments that will help guide Royal Berkshire Fire and Rescue Service through the coming years. Previously, the service had maintained the same commitments across the previous two community risk management plans, or integrated risk management plans as they were called at the time. As a service, though, with those external changes, we felt now was the right time to embark on a change of course. The new CRMP has been produced to best prepare us for the challenges of the future as we see them, and to make sure that we continue to put Royal Berkshire Fire and Rescue Service on a strong footing for the next 4 years and beyond. The commitments in this community risk management plan reflect our statutory duties and also priorities that we feel are important, that you've stated to us that you feel important as a fire authority and we feel are important as an SLT, so prevention, protection, response, resilience, sustainability and our people. So those commitments will be gone through in more detail in the presentation. And the final comment I'd like to make is that tonight what we'll be asking for, and I'm sure Paul will reiterate this, is this is a draft community risk management plan that we're presenting to members tonight. You have opportunity to agree and debate or not the principles within it, obviously, and make suggested amendments where appropriate. But ultimately, this is about agreeing the high-level principles that are based on a significant amount of risk analysis. And then we need to go out to consultation as part of that statutory consultation period. Obviously, we need to then listen to that feedback, make necessary amendments, and then bring forward again in February and agree a future CRMP to go out to the communities with. So tonight is really about those high level principles and agreeing a draft that we can go out to consultation with. So without further ado, Chair, I'd like to pass to Area Manager Paul Bremble, who will explain the proposed CRMP. Absolutely.
Over to you, Paul.
Thank you very much, Chief. Thank you very much, Chair. today we've brought to the Fire Authority for agreement to take to public consultation, as the Chief and the Chair has explained, the proposed new draft corporate plan and community risk management plan for 23 to 2027. This outlines the new set of draft commitments for the Fire Authority and new draft priorities for the service for the duration of the plan. As has already been stated, this has been created in line with the Fire and Rescue Service National Framework. Alongside that, we've also used the new Fire Standard Guidance for Community Risk Planning. The Royal Berkshire Fire Authority is required to set out its understanding of the risks it is responsible for mitigating in the community, and the corporate plan and community risk plan sets out for the Fire Authority how it intends to accomplish this, the risk mitigation. The plan is supported by the evidence-based document that was in the agenda pack. I'd just like to draw to your attention, there was a later iteration that was sent out that was a more revised version with the minutes with the pack that came later in the week, so apologies if you still have the old one. This outlines a detailed analysis of the evidence that has been used to develop this CRMP. As I said earlier, the plan is critical to shaping the future of the organisation, sets out our strategic priorities and ensures a measurable progress towards improving the safety of communities in Berkshire. It is a requirement for that the public is consulted on the plans along with internal and external stakeholders. And if these plans are agreed today, we intend to go out for consultation on the 9th of January for a period of 8 weeks. After this consultation period, we will return back to the Fire Authority with the outcomes of that consultation and recommendations. We intend to meet with members during the consultation to provide feedback as this comes in, and also to get feedback from yourselves to help shape this plan for the future. The priorities and commitments will be presented to you today are based on the evidence document that you have in the packs, as I stated earlier. It's also been worked up with member workshops that have been carried out over the past 2 months, as well as meet workshops held with the strategic leadership team over these months. I will now hand to Tim Readings, the group manager who's been leading for the CRMP and building this together with our data team, Becca Chapman, to run through how we have approached our risk analysis, the priorities and the commitments and the priorities, and how we intend to consult on this document.
Excellent, Tim. Thanks, Paul. Thank you, Chair. So I've got a fairly short PowerPoint presentation, and I just want to run through with you at the process that we've applied to producing our community risk management plan in draft. This time round, it's a little different from the way that we've worked before, but we think that it's a really comprehensive plan, and we've worked really, really hard to look at the full range of risks that communities in Berkshire may be subject to. And obviously the national framework itself asks us to assess all foreseeable fire and rescue service related risks, which is a huge and complex task. I think it's also important to note for us that our CRMP is not a document that's going to sit on a shelf for 4 years. Once it's produced, it's going to be a living document for us, and we will have an annual process to revisit our risks and ensure that we're on track throughout the whole lifespan of our community risk management plan. And essentially, we followed a set of well-developed national guidelines that have been set out by the National Fire Chiefs Council with a lot of input from Royal Berkshire. So Nikki Richards has delivered. Nikki Richards has delivered a number of parts of that, including a full strategic framework, which we followed in detail to make sure that our community risk management plan adheres to good practice. So you've had a sneak preview of it. The next slide is a video that we've produced for the public. So we're going to release it onto our website. And we've done some testing internally and through public engagement already on that. So I shall let you watch it, and I hope that you like it.
We want to help make Berkshire a safe place to live in, to work in, and to visit. To help us do this, we have a Community Risk Management Plan, or CRMP, which demonstrates how we will place and deploy our resources to keep people safe. We follow national guidance to produce our plan, and we use evidence and information to help us decide how we can have the greatest positive impact on public safety. We monitor risks to people, places, the environment, and the economy to help us decide which resources we need and where we should base them. By understanding risk in our community, we are better able to understand how best to prevent fires and emergencies, how to enforce fire safety law, and how to tackle emergencies when they happen. In preparing the plan, we consider a wide range of risks, from house fires, transport incidents and chemical spills, through to water rescues, building collapse, and terrorist attacks. Of course, we want to prevent incidents from happening in the first place, so we offer safety education to residents, prioritising the most vulnerable. We work in schools and run fire cadet schemes across the county to support safer communities. We also have a responsibility to enforce fire safety law. This means we work with businesses to help improve their fire safety, and where we discover serious issues, we have a legal power to prosecute those who do not follow our guidance. Our staff respond to emergencies 24 hours a day, 365 days of the year. We aim to attend incidents within 10 minutes on 75% of occasions. We train and equip our firefighters to respond safely and quickly to life-threatening emergencies. The Royal County of Berkshire spans 486 square miles and is diverse both in terms of its population and landscape, with a mix of urban and rural areas. Berkshire has an estimated population of close to 1 million people. It is home to major tourist attractions and historic buildings, such as Windsor Castle, and is a thriving area for business. As a fire and rescue service, we have to plan for how best to respond to different types of risk, such as high-rise buildings, which are predominantly located in Reading and Slough, major watercourses such as the River Thames and Kennet and Avon Canal, and rural areas like the North Wessex Downs area of outstanding natural beauty and Swinley Forest. Berkshire is well connected with no part of the county further than 8.5 miles from the M4 motorway and mainline rail links from London to Wales. We understand that communities across Berkshire have different needs, and it's very important to us to make this plan effective. Therefore, we want to understand the best ways to support people when they need us, and so we are asking for your input to help shape our plan. We want feedback from the community on how we can make our services relevant and accessible. Help us make Berkshire safer. Visit our website and have your say.
So that's going to be part of our consultation package, which, as Paul said, is due to be launched from January the 9th. We think it's a really effective tool for communications, and it's going to feature hopefully quite heavily in the work that we do going forwards. So this is the process broadly that we've followed to produce our community risk management plan. We set and agreed the scope, so the content of what would be in the plan, and then we approached the process by identifying the hazards, so major hazards that would affect the community, and then we carried out a process of risk assessment where we looked at the likelihood of a hazard being realised and then the consequences of that hazard being realised, and used that as the basis for our decision making for resourcing against that risk, and it was important to us to prioritise those risks that we felt were the most serious. And obviously once our community risk management plan is up and running, we'll be evaluating the process as we go along to ensure that we're achieving our stated goals. Thanks, Faith. So this diagram represents a revised vision for the organisation, and essentially it's what we do, how we do it and why we do it, and the what part is protection, prevention and response, and ensuring that we have a resilient organisation. And for us, resilience means that we can provide our services 24 hours a day, 365 days of the year, but it also means that we support local, regional and national response to larger scale incidents. The why is the community at the centre of what we do, and a key element for us really is around ensuring that our organisation is focused on risk, has the right capabilities, is sustainable going forwards, and as we've previously discussed with the London report, that our culture is positive and drives everything that we do as a fire and rescue service. So how do we predict risk? We have a great deal of data available to us, and we're increasingly a data-driven organisation. We looked at factors associated with risk, so where the impacts were around people, place, environment, economy and properties that would be affected if an incident happened, and we're able to look at Berkshire on an area basis or by property. So some of our data aligns very closely to individual premises, so people that are specifically at risk or buildings that we know are at high risk of fire, and then there are societal factors that drive our understanding of risk, and particularly linked to social deprivation across Berkshire, and there are close associations between vulnerability and risk. To check our understanding of risk, we drew back on 6 years of incident data, which goes back really to the start of Thames Valley Fire Control, as we felt that was when we had really the most robust recording mechanisms in place,
and we've verified risks that we've analysed against incident data that we have to ensure that our predictions around risk are as accurate as they are. Recognising that any risk prediction tool is never going to be 100% accurate. We don't have a crystal ball yet, but we're getting there. Thank you, Eric. Bloody thing. Right, so how do we work around risk? We look at a number of, we have a planning assumption in place already of responding to any incident in Berkshire within 10 minutes 75% of the time, and we felt that it was important for us to maintain that standard from the existing RMP through to the new CRMP that we're proposing to help us measure those changes as we go forwards. We've looked at which resources we've got, where they're located, do we think they're in the right place or not, how do our resources sit against risk, and then and for us it's been quite important to start thinking about how we can use all of the tools at our disposal in the most effective and efficient way. So it's not just about fire engines and how long they take to get to places, it's about all of the other prevention and protection services that we run in tandem with those, and ensuring that we're able to use the best fit of resource against risk that we face. So we've used software to help us do that. We have two bits of software, a workload modeler, which takes run times of fire engines and fire appliances from fire stations to incidents. We're able to look at what our reach looks like out of fire stations, and then test scenarios against that. And this helps us to ensure that our fire stations are in the right place and that we have the right amount of fire engines at those fire stations. We've also got a second piece of software called a risk modeler. And risk modeler allows us to put all of the other factors in to look at the hazard by area, and then overlaying those two pieces of software allows us to see what our coverage looks like against the risk that we've identified. And we've run our modelling across the year to look at seasonal fluctuations, and across day and night to look at peak demands at different times. So there are a great deal of different hazards that we have to mitigate, and we haven't got time to go through all of them tonight, but we are going to talk briefly about dwelling fires. It's really the primary risk that fire and rescue services are associated with. And there's a well-developed national model available from the National Fire Chiefs Council, which we've used to map dwelling fire risk across Berkshire. This model doesn't use any incident data. It looks very heavily at factors associated with risk of fire, and they include things like home ownership, so renters are more likely to have a dwelling fire than somebody who owns their own home. Type of accommodation, so flats and semi-detached houses are more likely to have fires. Car use, so if you don't have a car at home or have access to a vehicle, you're more likely to have a dwelling fire. And then the other factors on that list, they're really all, I think, all around poverty and deprivation are real drivers for risk, unfortunately. So we've modelled that, and this is what it looks like for Berkshire. So this map has subdivisions on it. Each one is a lower super output area. That represents 650 dwellings, or about 1,200 people. So geographically, the much smaller areas in Reading and Slough carry the same weight as the larger rural, less population dense areas. And broadly what this tells us is that our dwelling fire risks are mainly associated with Reading and Slough and urban areas, that there is much less dwelling fire risk in rural areas, although there is a pocket of medium risk in West Berkshire, primarily around Hungerford. And it's really what you would expect, I think. Risk generally goes where the people are. But our fire stations are aligned pretty much with where that risk is, so we took some degree of reassurance from that. So as we've discussed, we've set out some revised strategic commitments for the fire authority, and essentially it is really around ensuring that we're providing the best service to the communities that we are responsible for looking after, and ensuring that we are a resilient, robust organisation. And you will have seen them in the pack. So what do we intend to do? We're going to consult around six priority areas. We want to build our integrated service delivery model to allow us the flexibility to meet the changes in risk that we've identified. We've got a fairly robust horizon scanning process. We spent a lot of time looking at it. We think we need to prepare Berkshire for the impact of climate change. It is a longer process than the four-year lifespan of the Community Risk Management Plan, but there's great work for us to do. We've been through a peak demand period in the summer this year. We see no reason why it would be any different next year. Met Office weather modelling that we look at tells us that we anticipate wetter winters and more flooding. So we do need to prepare the organisation to be able to manage that changing risk pattern across the county. And for us, it's also about ensuring that we use the right parts of our service to meet risk wherever possible, bearing in mind we can't have a fire station and a fire engine available in every town and village across Berkshire. We do have to align our resources to where the risk is, but where our response, our ability to respond varies, we need to ensure that we can meet that with enhanced prevention and protection activities, and developing an integrated service delivery strategy will allow us to do that. For priority two, we do aim to develop a risk-based prevention programme. We have a risk-based inspection programme for enforcing fire safety law. We need a similar model for our protection services. It will help us to identify where we can have the greatest impact delivering safe and well visits to the most vulnerable residents, ensuring that our fire safety education packages in schools and road safety packages are aligned to those areas of greatest risk. And we think that it's a really important change that we need to make. Priority three says that we'll be developing our response model to provide the most effective response to incidents in Berkshire, and it sits alongside priority one. We think those two priorities will deliver in tandem, but we need to ensure that our service is sustainable and we've got the right resources in the right place, and looking carefully at our response model and the way we crew our appliances will help us to deliver. Next slide. So priority four, we need to look at incident types that we attend. What we're saying here is that it's really important for us to ensure that we are very good at delivering our bread and butter jobs. We need to be really, really good at delivering our statutory duties, and we need to ensure that we are delivering the best possible service. And for us, I think this is really important, and it's a requirement in the national framework that we can do work that aren't statutory duties, but we have to ensure that in doing that, we aren't detracting at all from delivering our core services. And so this is a process for us to review that and ensure that we are on track and a capable, efficient and effective fire and rescue service. So priority five. Talks about protection, so enforcing fire safety law. We've already got our risk-based inspection programme. We want to review that to make sure that that's working well for us. And we feel that there are ways and means of improving the service that we deliver. We'd like to explore increased fire safety training for operational crews. So at the moment, our fire safety inspecting officers will prioritise those highest risk properties for their enforcement activity. There's a layer below that we, because they aren't the highest risk, we have less interaction with. But there's still a statutory requirement under Section 6 of the Fire and Rescue Services Act for us to educate, and there's an opportunity there for us to provide extra value into the community. And priority 6 is a really important one. So it says we'll provide a minimum of 14 frontline fire appliances. We already do that. But we've got 19 fire engines in Berkshire, and what we want to aim for is having our 19 appliances available wherever possible. And the driver there is to improve our retained firefighters' availability. At the moment, they're not in the current RMP. They're talked about as a resilience asset, and we want to bring them into the organisation and talk less about them being a resilience asset. Talk more about them as a usable asset for fire and rescue service. So that's where we're going to head. It's really a driver for embracing whole time and on call within the service to get the most possible utility out of the resources that we've got available to us. So how will we consult? We will run our consultation from the 9th of January for 10 weeks up until the 28th of March. We've already started doing pre-engagement both inside Royal Berkshire and with some public sessions as well to gauge feeling in the community. But this is going to be a really big driver for us, and it's really important that we make the consultation a success. I think we've got a good track record in Royal Berkshire of running effective consultations, and I see no reason for this being any different.
So, okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, Tim. Thank you for that. Thank you for outlining those for you. As we said earlier, this is the draft community corporate power and community risk management plan for the next 4 years, and this is about taking this out to consultation to the public and to get their feedback in order to shape and develop this for the future over the next 3 months at their consultation period. I'll hand you back to the chair, if there's any further questions.
Yeah. Well, so before I move this, are there any questions? I'll take Councillor Lovelock first.
I don't know whether that's gone right now. I'm just wondering, in terms of the consultation, obviously you're all good response, how you're going to be ensuring that, if you like, all sections of the community, age-wise, background, so on and so forth, actually know about it and are enthused to take part. I didn't expect thousands and thousands of people, but I guess you see something on the website or on social media which says comment on our corporate plan. It's not the biggest turn on in the world, is it really? So what plans are there to, if you like, make people interested enough to bother about it?
So we've got a pretty good consultation plan in place already, and we've developed a really wide set of community contacts, and we've already started reaching out to them. So I don't see this process as being a purely online, a virtual process. I think we are going to be reaching out into the community to try and engage, and we're really aware that you can exclude a lot of people just by having a social media only approach. It doesn't suit everyone, and it's really important to us to reach out into underrepresented communities, because we don't hear from everyone, and we recognise that there's more work for us to do to deliver that. I think we're in a fairly good place, but recognise that there's more improvement required.
Yeah, thanks. Did you want to say anything on that, Paul?
Just to say we've got a consultation strategy that is aligned nationally and has been looked at externally on how we approach consultations, and they very much endorse our processes of how we use it currently. Through this process, we will use all our resources available, stations, fire stations, and get them to go to the communities that we can't reach through social media to talk about this new proposal going forward. So we are trying to use as many avenues as possible to get out and into the community to get this consultation across to people.
Thanks. I think it is clearly important with the detail here that the members of the public read this and see the work that goes into it. Councillor Elliott-Simon.
First of all, a very big thank you to everybody that's been involved in putting this very comprehensive document together. It really is good. And over the years, it's moved on and become better and better. And my questions relate to an issue or two on page 40. And incidentally, I'm very happy to see the chart at the top there, which outlines the golden thread that's gradually been developing and is now in place between the CRMP and individuals' PDRs. That's one of the big things that has developed so well over the last few years. My questions relate to phrases such as, for each hazard we manage, we will consider all the methods at our disposal to drive out risk communities, and we'll identify the most effective and efficient way to reduce community risk. One of these methods is the safe and well visits, and I notice elsewhere in the papers that we want to increase the numbers of these to vulnerable people. I've got four questions about that, which are all interrelated. So I'll ask them all at once, so I'm happy to repeat them separately if that's helpful at the end. Firstly, how effective is each of the six unitary authorities in passing on information about vulnerable people? And secondly, are we still in regular contact to get that information from the three major departments of adult social care, housing and children's services? In Wokingham, we have a named person responsible in each of those departments whose job it is to pass on that information. Which leads to the third question. Is there a named person in each of the unitary authorities under each of these three departments? I know that's 18 people, but that gives us a lot of information. And are we in contact with those people? And lastly, might we consider including a commitment to ask each unitary authority to identify such people? That could perhaps go at the end of the middle paragraph on page 40. I'm happy to repeat those individually if that's a help.
Chair, if I may.
Yeah, thank you.
Councillor, thank you for the questions. Really, really insightful questions there. So I think it's important that we look at the current methodology that we use to identify the most vulnerable people from across the county. At the moment, we carry out an adult referral program where we go out to various organisations that work with vulnerable people in the community, and we train them to recognise vulnerabilities that make them additionally at risk from fire. They then make a direct referral into us. We then categorise those referrals depending on the different vulnerabilities that they exhibit to prioritise how quickly we should get to each of them. So that's the current method that we use. And we really do reach out. So it's beyond just social services. It's going out to carers, groups, Meals on Wheels, anybody we can provide training to help them to identify that vulnerability. One of the big challenges that we have is to make sure that we operate within GDPR regulations. So what we can't do is just turn around to an organisation and say, tell us about all your vulnerable people. We have to make sure there is informed consent, which is where the adult referral programme works so well, because whilst making the referral, referral agencies then ask for that consent for their information to be passed on to ourselves. But always looking for new avenues that we can explore. So I'm more than happy to hook up with the local authorities and their social services where we possibly can in order to get more referrals in.
Thank you. Okay. But I didn't sort of get an answer to the last bit of my question, which was could we add in something about working with local authorities as well as with the police and ambulance, just for completeness.
So we made a question to that. Clearly, it's important to liaise with local authorities. As we said, we're at another level as well of that outside of the sorry, when you.
If I can, Chair,
yeah, of course.
Maybe we can certainly when we conduct that member consultation in the new year, but also with the public consultation, collate all the kind of feedback that comes back to identify if that's a theme that comes out. But what I would also draw attention to is the chart that you talk about at the top of page 40 that also alludes to that integrated service delivery strategy, but then the local safety plans and the partnerships that exist locally between the hubs and the unitary authorities. So whether it sits at the top level in the CRMP or whether it's identified more locally, it's something I think we could look into throughout the consultation period.
Yeah, I think the point is using consultation. Members' input is welcome. So there's a lot which can change. I'm going to go, Councillor Linden, I think you indicated first, then Councillor Brooks. I think actually Councillor Bates had actually indicated first. Actually, thanks to Councillor Bates. I'm sorry, I've just.
Thank you. A lot has been said about the role cleared as far as I'm concerned on my question. But the thing that does worry me is that it's these tall buildings. And I know this because Maidenhead now is suddenly rising up with huge tall buildings. The fact is that when people who say that when people come in to an apartment there, they're probably given some papers to read, etc., etc. But I think that one of the things that would nudge them all the time is if it's possible for somebody in uniform or two or three people in uniform go around and have a meeting one evening every year, and that'll frighten them a little bit. And so therefore I think that they would be more active in anything that might go wrong. And that's all I want to say about it, because everything else has been said.
So a question about capacity to do that, isn't it? So yes, Chair, if I may again, I think again a really valid point. And I think this is probably where the risk-based prevention programme will come in. As we identify vulnerability within the communities, that will enable us to focus our resources towards the risk. So it may well identify circumstances such as those described. Of course, there's other ways and means that we can utilise to ensure that residents are provided with information with regard to their building, and that the accountable person makes sure that information is readily available to them, the use of signage and also through letters of communication with people who are living within the building. But certainly I think the prevention risk-based programme will assist with that.
But you haven't really answered my question, which is somebody in uniform or two or three people going in once a year, because there will be changes each year, obviously.
And I think that comes down to identifying the finite resource that we've got and making sure that it's targeted at the appropriate risk. And as I say, that is where I think by having a risk-based approach to our prevention activities, we will identify that risk. And if it's identified that risk is indeed in tall buildings, then that will ensure that resource is focused there.
Thank you. And of course, since the last CRMP, there's been a lot more high-rise buildings built in the county, and that has to be assessed in terms of the risk. Councillor Brooks.
I've got a couple of questions, then you'll let us come back later. With
yes, of course.
Points
yeah.
On
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Itself, right, okay.
Put this thing on. What? How will you measure the success of this consultation? Say we've got a very good consultation process. How will you know it's been very good when it closes? Have you got a sort of benchmark that you're looking for in terms of responses to substantiate the point that you think is very good? And my other one is a little bit more technical, about structure. On page 53, what is the strategic performance board? Who's on it? Are members involved? Because suddenly we've seen something, neither myself nor the vice chair recognise, a strategic performance board will monitor the key performance measures. So perhaps for the chief rather than Paul. But two questions there, please. Oh, do you want to say?
Yeah, Paul, sorry.
through you, Chief Chair. So with respect to the consultation strategy, it is benchmarked against the Fire Consultation Institute, and we look across the sectors of the communities, the number of responses we get across age, across different demographics, and there is some benchmarking data across the sector to tell you what's good and what's not. So we will be looking to compare our results against that. In our recent inspection for HMI, we presented quite a sizable amount of data around that, and it was shown to be sort of best practice across the sector, so hopefully we can carry that forward. With respect to the strategic performance
hang on, will you share that with us, please?
The results of the consultation, yes.
Well, no, the benchmark that you talked about as well.
We'll share the information,
Thank you.
Yeah, with when we can, because some of that's a bit embargoed, but yes, with respect to the strategic performance board, that is chaired by myself and all members of SLT sit on it, and it is where it's a service based internal meeting, the results of which go to audit and governance.
So you're the strategic leadership team, and you're also the strategic performance board. Is there a danger you're marking your own homework?
Well, with all due respect, that homework then goes on to audit and governance. So yes. I think in terms of it's appropriate within the service.
So that's reported through the board.
Thank you. Thank you. So we can mark the homework.
I'm going to go to Councillor Smith, actually, then Councillor Linden.
Thank you, Chair. I recognise there's a considerable amount of work that's gone into this, considerable amount of evidence in the evidence base pack, the appendix that's with this. But one thing I think is a little bit missing here relates to something that we began as an authority a year ago, where we were looking at automatic fire alarms and whether or not by changing practices and procedures as to how we respond to these, we could strike the right balance of being able to respond, but also to reduce the number of times that firefighters were actually called out to these. Well, I look at this number here on the demand side for the service on page 9. Well, the number screams out at me, automatic fire alarm cases 3,047. But I see in the evidence pack there's mention on page 60 of the fact that, that's a big problem for us. But we're not getting any feedback really as to what the impact has been, albeit for less than a year, of the change we made. And in particular, did we go far enough or not far enough? And you know, where did we actually strike that balance in the future? Because we were talking about saving literally thousands of firefighter working hours a year. And if we can do that, then that's going to have a huge performance impact. So I agree with all the stuff that's going on here, but I do think that's one omission I'd like to see.
Frame that as a question. Do you want to frame that as a question, Councillor?
Would you agree with me?
Would you agree? Yeah. Would you agree with my comments?
Yes. Thank you very much, Joe.
Thank you, Councillor. We we recognise that with the automatic fire alarms. There's only a small bit in the evidence package that's based around risk rather than the actual automatic fire alarms themselves. And it is in the document about the fire alarms, as you pointed out there, and we recognise the impact that's having on the service and the changes that we've done currently, which is why in priority 5 we've put it down as another area of work that needs to continue to reduce that impact. In the fire, from our crews, our resources being taken up time within those calls all the time, it's nearly 50% of our calls currently. So we do propose that we need to do more work around that, and that is up for discussion and for consultation on where that goes to next.
Just conscious that I should be addressing it as a question. Do we have any data yet, even if it's only a half year, a set of data that is telling us?
All the changes.
Have we gone in the right direction? Have we done enough?
So, we've got a review scheduled in for January to look at the impact, but I think from the work we've done so far, we don't feel like it's had a big significant impact and changed the amount of automatic fire alarm responses we've been required to make. So I think we do need to do more, but priority four and five together both allow us the capacity to change, I think, the way we respond to automatic fire alarms. But as Paul pointed out, we can consider them as a hazard. They are something that depletes our resources rather than being necessarily a community hazard. So we've given ourselves, I think, enough leeway in the CRMP to be able to make some changes.
So, Chief, do you want to say something?
Thank you, Chair. Yeah, just to support Tim's points there, I think the comment we made back in February at the Fire Authority meeting when members took the decision around amending the AFA policy was that we bring the 12-month review back to members. We review and evaluate the approach. We bring the report back to members for decision. And I would support Tim's point that particularly priority five in here indicates how we'll take that forward. I also accept that I think it probably could jump off the page a little bit more because it is quite important. Even if you look at the HMICFRS website, that gives a breakdown of the demand that Royal Berkshire Fire and Rescue Service faces as a service, and a high proportion of that demand is automatic fire alarm. So we probably could bring it off the page a little bit more, and I'm sure that will come out through the consultation process. Yeah.
I'll probably go back to audit governance or what to a committee that report was. On this, thanks for the question, Councillor Smith. Councillor Linden.
Yes, thanks, Chair. Yeah, I'll make my comments later, so I'll ask the questions. I was looking in two parts of the report. One was the aerial appliance, and I noticed that London's got a higher reach on some of their appliances. And I'm referring to obviously our high rises. There's one actually planned in the town of Newbury, which is going to be quite high, and there's obviously Reading and Slough and a couple of Maidenhead. So would we be considering having a secondary vehicle that can go even higher for rescue? That's my first question. The second, which I think, and I'd like to thank the officers for this hard work, mind you. But I think there's something missing, which is state-on-state risks. I know we mentioned cyber, but you know the traditional parts of civil defence. I did go to Easenwold a couple of decades ago before we became a unitary council. West Berkshire, called Newbury in those days, district council. And it affects, obviously, where there are risks around the world. Obviously in Europe and also in the Indo-Pacific, well, the Pacific area really, but Indo-Pacific as well, in terms of state-on-state, and some of them are high risks. And I think really we need to mention that. I think it's important, obviously, terrorism, cyber, and state players supported by terrorist groups and other groups. But I think we need to go wider on some pretty nasty stuff. And I know, just using one of our officers, our managers actually, Karen Richardson, who's in the reserves, who covers three local authorities, West Barks, Maidenhead, Royal Borough, Windsor, Maidenhead, and Bradford Forest Borough Council. So I think it is important that we do go into that kind of planning as well. And that's something that has been missing. So it's those two questions.
Wouldn't you agree?
So I'll pick up the second question, if I may. We do take account of the National Security Risk Assessment when we developed our Community Risk Management Plan, and we refer to the Thames Valley Local Resilience Forum Community Risk Register as well. And we chair the local risk group within Thames Valley NRF. So we have taken account of those wider regional and national risks when we've developed our plan. And further to that, we've got we're contacting counter-terrorism policing, and they've said that they would be happy to look over our assessment of threat, particularly around terror for Berkshire. And we can achieve that through our inter-agency liaison officer network. So we are doing that. And you did also mention Karen Richards. She's coming down to see us in January.
Yeah. And we've got some pretty good talking here well. About the military stuff, mm. you know, with MOD and intelligence agencies. Mm. I know you have the link in with it. You mentioned MI5, yeah. but also MI6, GSHQ, and the other areas. But it is important that we do link in with the more than just and the police. Of course, the police have got a vital role to play, but the wider role needs to go further than that.
Yeah,
and the cabinet contingency office.
True. I have asked a contact in the intelligence services whether they'd be happy to look at our assessment of threat for Berkshire, and they've said that they would do that.
Okay. And the aerial ladder, Chair.
The chief's going to take that.
One of the short version, Councillor Linda. No, it's the short version. when we replaced the new ALP over at Whitley Ward recently, that was conducted as a result of risk analysis, including the height of buildings, the nature of the incidents that we go to, and even when you consider those extremely large vehicles that London have built, they still can't reach the top of the high-rise buildings in London. So it's not about just the vehicle reaching the building. It's about lots of other capability that we need that vehicle to actually achieve and also be able to get into the incident. So the decision that you took as an authority to purchase the 45-metre ALP that we've got took account of the size of the high-rise and the nature of the risk that we've got, but also the demographics of whether we can get the vehicle to the incident. There's a lot more around fire engineered solutions in buildings, escape plans, prevention, the protection environment that complements the response to an emergency in a tall building like that. The size of the high rise really doesn't make that much difference. They're predominantly used as water towers as opposed to rescue platforms.
Thank you, Chair. Councillor Logan.
Thank you, Chair. And thank you for the quite comprehensive presentation. And I love data because I think data is quite key when you're making decisions, but also data exposes other things as well. And I understand that this is draft, but I want to pick up from what Councillor said over there, which kind of addresses my concerns. So my question is, to what extent is the ethnical diversity reflected in the report born into your prioritization and your activities? And I'll tell you why. Because you said that you talked about high-risk incidents and the correlation between that and deprivation of poverty. And there's a high correlation between deprivation of poverty and ethnic minorities. The data is out there. You talked about high incidents in Reading and Slough, and you have major conurbation of ethnicities there. And I didn't hear, and perhaps that's the issue, I didn't hear anything around the significance of that data and how you propose to implement your prioritization. And maybe if you were going to give examples around it, that would be quite clear. Mm-hmm. And again, in terms of how you propose to engage, because the structures that we talk about, that they don't just catch fire or things. It's about people. Essentially, this is about people. And there's a lot of education and awareness. And language, and in such diverse communities, language is a major issue. So I don't understand to what extent, again, is that being reflected, again, in the plan you're putting in place and your prioritization. So perhaps you can clarify, elucidate with a few more examples, how do you plan to engage with the communities? You said your plan is good, but you didn't qualify it. You didn't quantify it. You just made the statement. I looked through this and I picked one word just jumped at me when you talked about open fires, that you would engage with landowners. Now, is that where the risk is? Because I don't know. I mean, again, it's the data that you have. So perhaps more clarification, examples around why you've gone down this path, and just so that it's very clear that these issues are born in your prioritization, because one size doesn't fit all.
clearly what you're going to do in West Berkshire is not going to be the same you'll do in Reading or Slough. But even in Calcot, I use myself as an example. I've lived in Calcot for almost 30 years, and nobody's ever asked me any question.
Okay. Well, I think it was easy enough for a move, but I think you're pointing some talk. It's a question, isn't it, guys, if you want to sort of field that?
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Very good question. And as we said in the presentation, we have used census data. Around the domestic, and we have sets of data that we use to interpret and define data and define where our risks are and where we look through. And if I go through that as an example through this, when we look in our safe and well visits, and as we've driven through that, and I'm talking this specifically in terms of the integrated service delivery strategy approach, we recognise that there's areas in Slough that have got those hard to reach ethnic communities from there that we haven't been able to get into, talking about safe and well. And that's where that has helped us to come away from. So this is a high level document, remember, to step back and say, okay, so we've probably got some work that we need to do around identifying groups that we can't reach, or we have found difficulty reaching through our data that we've used for the safe and well, as an example. And that feeds into our priority number two, which is about building that risk-based prevention program, because we recognise all the work that we do does hit a group of people and numbers of people as best we can with the data we've got, but actually we can go further. And that is about identifying those groups that that piece of work is about identifying those groups further down to go, okay, how are we going to reach those groups? How are we going to target our most vulnerable around their ethnicity, around their age, around their vulnerability to risk? So that is why that priority two is in there. We recognise we need to do that piece of work around that area in there.
Thank you. I mean, there's also, I think there is a role for members here, you know, representing these communities as well. But thanks very much, Paul. I think Nicky wanted to say something as well.
Just in general principles is that this has got an equality impact assessment that goes with the overall document, so it looks at different areas and communities, and we will do an equality impact assessment for every project that we take forward so that we are specific in targeting and segmenting those groups. We do analyse our data at the moment across different groups based on the work that we've done around the internships, for example, to understand and better segment our groups in the community, and we've also referred to quality of access documents that have been produced by the National Fire Chiefs Council, which look at particular segments of the community to help us better understand, because it's kind of, if you don't know what you're looking for, then how do you know what to look for? And trying to understand from our own experiences working with diverse communities around what was the learning that we've developed there. So it is an iterative process in terms of how we're going through at each stage and considering at each stage what would be the implication of this recommendation to those different parts of the community. So it is that part of the process is very much a live running process. And the national structure and the national fire standard says that equality of access should be an iterative process. So when you analyse the data, you should look at the communities, but then when you get the results of the data back, you should look at the communities, and you should look at the outcomes from your proposals through the lens of those communities that you're serving. So we're at the beginning of that cycle of starting to look at our data and our hazards. And the hazards are predominantly not based on people. They are things like dwelling fires and those kind of things. So there are certain socio and economic indicators that we've looked at, but they are not specific to race or to religion or to those factors. They're more at that kind of higher level, I suppose. So we will need to keep going around this quality and quality of access, and we do that now much more readily with all of our projects. So both our consultation strategy, that's recently gone through an EIA process, and we worked with external bodies for that, including the Disability Network, to see whether any of our sort of assumptions, whether there was any unconscious bias in the way that we were putting things forward. So we are on a journey with it. It's not perfect yet, but we've got it in train to keep going around that loop.
Thank you.
I think the chair has summed it up very well, that you've got members who are facing the communities, and I think they're probably a very reliable source of information and contacts. A lot of the documentation referred to and boards and things which are like, I don't even know where they are. But you have people here who are in the communities who know what's going on, and I think it's an opportunity to really leverage the members.
Thank you. Absolutely. Councillor Brown, how are you?
Sorry, thank you, Chair. I just wondered if anyone had considered having a chat for the on the Radio Berkshire for the launch to promote the consultation, or on local TV. And has anyone considered in the cultural bit talking to Tan Daisy MP, who has about 14 or 15 different languages, and he can tell you quite a lot.
Well, I think I'm going to do a video message, which I'm sure will get people to the consultation, but I think media communication is really important, most from both members, if you're asked, and perhaps from me as the chair, and also for officers, so anybody else to pick that up.
Yeah, so there's a comms plan that goes with that consultation strategy, and actually Tandesai is one of the people that we've sat down with to try to understand his networks and see what relationships we were looking to try to develop community forums, and he was somebody that we went to as a good contact to be able to help us in that area. So yes, good suggestions, and anybody who wants to do presentations, we'll be very happy to support you with the information.
So Councillor Linda, what's for?
Yeah, I've just got following on for Councillor Brown's point, and obviously social media, I presume we're going to be linking this presentation to it. I think it's useful to speak to the MPs, all our MPs in Berkshire, and also the local print media as well, which we most probably miss out on, as well as the BBC and ITV. So I think that's an important point. Jim, this is not a question, but it's just a brief point. I just stated that my sprinter's motion went to the executive for some peculiar reason, and they amended it. So from the National Fire Chiefs Council, I put it in July 2021, it got lost, and we've had a few things missing. Now, my seconder is Councillor Jeff Brooks, and I'd like to thank him for that help and assistance on that, but unfortunately they slightly watered it down, so we'll put it up all
the way. They watered it down is
they left it to discretion of officers whether they're going to install sprinklers or not.
Yeah. Well, I think it's important that the members take these things up, work in their communities, you know, to publicise through social media that we're doing this consultation and so various radio appearances, goodness what else. So I think points were made. I'm actually at this point now going to actually formally move the recommendations, which are 2.1 to 2.7. I have a seconder, Councillor Brooks. Yeah, do you want to talk a bit? Do you want to have a seconder, Councillor Shepherd Bay? Excellent. Myself, and yeah, and we're going to take them on block.
Yeah.
And Councillor Brooks, you've indicated you want to speak.
Yeah. I didn't shrink from seconding it. I think better if the Vice Chair did. There's good reason to second it. There's a lot in here. It's a comprehensive plan. So please take the comments I'm about to make in context with that broad positive statement of what you've got here to go and so on. A small nitpick on page 16 of the document. We have identified a need to develop a comprehensive response to the impact of climate change. Sounds entirely pretentious. Can we not put it within the context of the impacts the service is experiencing because of climate change? You're literally putting yourselves at hostage fortune that you are going to provide a comprehensive response to the impact of climate change throughout the world. I don't think you mean that. And I'm being a bit flippant, but it's important you think about
context. On page 18, we talk about a minimum of 14 appliances, frontline fire appliances, being the minimum. Now, if I was being cynical, I could say, well, why have you got 19 then? And what are your KPIs? What would be the optimum of having, where would you get to 14, Chief, is what I'm saying. Because once you say 14 is the minimum, are you always at 14? Because that's the danger. And as a member of the public, I say, well, they could get 14 all the time then. Are they going to have a target of only going to 14 10% of the time? Or whatever, I'm not putting words in there. Okay? But I think it's a little bit too open-ended there to say we're going to have a minimum 14. It's a worry to me. And finally, well done on the routes to consultation. I wouldn't use your cartoon. I know you call it an animated video. And you probably saw it in a Virgin Atlantic flight sometime. But you're in danger of dumbing down what you're trying to get across with a cartoon like that, that you see, I expect to see in primary school. I'm sorry to be rather blunt about this, and I'm sorry if I'm calling your baby ugly, but I think the cartoon, I'm struggling to know what audience you're trying to get. You're trying to get something that says, look, here's a complex subject and we're trying to make it easy for you, but you're in danger of playing Jack and Rory, I think, with that, really. So anyway, use it by all means. I don't know what your target is for it, but it didn't work for me. But let me finish on high. I think there's a lot of good in here. I very much look forward to telling people to respond. Thank you, Joe.
Thank you, Councillor Brown.
Yeah, in response to Councillor Brooks'
good
feedback, we're trying to reach people who are vulnerable and don't like life in a complicated fashion. So I think it's entirely appropriate, and we shouldn't be judging from our point of view. We're not the people they're trying to access. So I think that the cartoon video is really great.
So one in favour of the cartoon, but no, this is what it's that's kind of out of test. But any other member want to speak on this before I move the recommendations in for?
Look, I'm the lead member for this, and I take on board Councillor Brooks's comments. When that's the purpose of the consultation, members can also put in their comments, and that, you know, so they're probably just presenting as a fait accompli, saying that's that. The members of public members can, and obviously hopefully engage with their communities, and to use the term hard to reach communities, so that they can put into this. So whether it's from a cartoon or a document or from an email or a text, we want people to reply to. We need feedback. We need public feedback. We need your feedback. And I think actually, if you look at the document from the one we moved, was it 3-4 years ago? It has fairly fundamental changes here. And I think we do reflect climate change as a priority in it, because the events of the recent months and years have shown it very much to be so. And you know, from the flooding and also some terribly tragic incidents that happened last summer as well, all of which are linked in some way to that. But as you say, Councillor Brooks, we can't claim we're going to solve climate change here, but we can mitigate against the its impact. But as I say, in terms of the use of the whole time appliances and the retained appliances, the on-call appliances, that is a kind of fundamental change. We must make sure we have a minimum of 14 on the run. But it's empowering the on-call stations to step up and give them a proper prominence and a role. I think particularly at night, and particularly in some of the more rural areas where the risk is less, but nonetheless the risk does exist. So I'm proud of you, obviously, these recommendations, but this is going to come back when we get the the feedback from the public was so I move this and hope everybody can vote in favour. So all those in favour of item recommendations, 2.1 to 2.7. Any against? Any abstentions? No. Okay, thank you very much, members, and thank you to the officers for the presentation and for answering the questions. Thanks very much for that. Okay, we can move quickly on to item 11, which obviously we did come to the last meeting, but we took seven bits of it back up to members' feedback. So this is to approve the amended standing orders, the review of the constitution and governance arrangements. I'm going to ask Mr. Britton to give a brief overview of this.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Chairman. The report starts at page 121 of your agenda pack. The two recommendations are set out on that page. The second of those recommendations are 2.2. And is to reflect the request of the chair and the vice chair that the language within the constitution document be amended to be gender neutral. As the chair indicated, the background to the proposed amendments are set out in some detail in the minutes of your October meeting. The reason for bringing this back to members of the apology this evening. The additional amendments primarily focus on presiding over the election of the chairman at the annual meeting and also who presides over the election of the chairman for the committee meetings. The default position at the annual meeting was, as members may recall, that the member presiding over the election of the chair for the municipal year would be the outgoing chair, the outgoing vice chair, and we had some very good feedback from a couple of members indicating what would happen in the event of two possibilities, one that the vice chairman be absent from the annual meeting, be that through unavoidable absence or not being returned by the appointing authority of the vice chairman, and also what would happen should the vice chairman wish to stand as chair, as the chair, and no days on the own election. So this has been elaborated on the sequence of events set out on page 127 as a new standard order, SO1A. In respect of committee meetings, the default position was that a member would be elected from those on the subcommittee as to who would preside over the election of the chair of the committee for the municipal year, and the mechanism for doing this has now been elaborated, and that's on page 144 of your agenda pack. And if, in the event of that process resulting in an equality of vote, then the vice chairman preside. And again, there was some good feedback at the last full authority meeting about what happened. You know, in trying to do that, we'll discuss the vice chairman being absent. So that has now been elucidated such that the new SO107B would apply. Chairman, I don't think you need to go on in further in respect of those amendments that are coming back to the authority.
Any questions on this? I think we had a long session on this at the last meeting. These are highlighted in the agenda packs, these revised changes. Any questions? No? Oh, Councillor Bates.
I'm sorry, but on 2.2, you say that it's going to change to chair and vice chair. I'm sorry, I wasn't at the meeting in October, if that was brought up then. But I can't see any reason why we're changing it from being chairman or vice chairman.
Okay, well, I don't...
It sounds as if we're in America or something. I'm like, why can't we use either?
To frame that as a question, I think actually Mr. Britton's, what should I say, summary of this, he did actually use both. But I think this is potentially, we're moving on to the bit where we're actually moving it. I think this essentially is about modernity, it's about
equality and the way people are labelled. I mean, some people, you know, find this difficult. Others think this is the right way to go. I have to say that as the chair of the authority, I did ask for these changes to be made, and I think hopefully I've got the support of members in this. We're in the sort of question bit. But I'm actually now, because there's no other questions, I'm actually going to formally move these recommendations. Then we can have a debate and people can make comments. So I'm going to move it. Can I have a second? Councillor Shepherd to Bay. And I'm going to go, Councillor Bates, and you've obviously made comments on this. That's fine, absolutely fine. Councillor Wright, you wanted to say something?
No, I was just giving you a thumbs up.
Oh, you give me the thumbs up. Okay, well, that's helpful. Everybody give me the thumbs up? Right, okay, well, I think we've had a lot of people give me the thumbs up. People have got different views on this, but I think it's about modernity, it's about equality, and I personally think that most... all authorities, this is standard practice across the local authority model. But some people disagree with it, others don't. Councillor Linden.
Yeah. Sorry. Right. I think what we should be able to do is, you know, one has all these private views, but I think the main thing is you don't want to offend people. And that's why in this environment, I've said chair and whatever. You know, I'm very happy on West Berkshire to have the traditional Mr. and Madam Chairman, and I respect that. But I think it depends on your organisation and the feeling of what's going on. You don't really want to offend people, and I think, you know, it's a degree on how people wish to be treated, and that's what I should say, Chair.
Thank you. Any other members want to come? Councillor Simon.
Thank you. I accept that this is a personal comment, but I just still do object very strongly to 2.2. Chairman and Vice Chairman are positions. They're not gender related and they're nothing to do with equality. I personally have two legs, not four, and I don't go crawling on all fours. And I feel very upset at being referred to as a piece of furniture. In fact, I feel rather offended by it. And that's why I'm going to vote against 2.2. In Wokingham, we are still chairman and vice chairman, as I believe a lot of other authorities are. And because I'm going to vote against 2.2, I shall therefore have to abstain in 2.1, although I do appreciate the work that's gone into rejigging this report. But I feel very, very unhappy. I'm very offended at the use of the word chair and vice chair.
Councillor Lovell.
Is to come
on again? I've got 2 minutes. Councillor Bates, if you turn your mind off.
Sorry.
It's all right.
I think that's it. Now, I don't want to prolong this, Chair, because we did have a long lag. We didn't get any of these arguments last time. And I do feel quite strongly. I'm quite sad, actually, that it's two women from over there that are objecting to this, because a lot of this dates back, chairman and all the rest of it, to when it was just a bunch of men in grey suits who were chairing things. And we've come a long way now. In Reading, we've been chair for, God, I think 30-odd years, and nobody bats an eyelid on any side of the world. We've got one member now, I think, that insists on calling me chairman at the planning committee, but frankly, it's time we moved on from this and recognise that society's moved on from the days when we invented committees and chairmen. Thank you.
Councillor Brown?
Yes, I think of firemen and firefighters at this point, and it really isn't appropriate to call women firemen. I'm sorry. And I think it is part of, as you say, modernity. We're progressing. And the other members of society would like to be very offended by it. It brings to mind actually a very personal thing. Back in the 90s, I'd become a councillor for the first time. I was a councillor for a couple of years. And I went to a meeting just after I was married. And they changed my nameplate to Mrs. and the new name. I was very upset and offended. because I'm keeping mine, I'm not changing it, thanks. I'm an individual, I don't want to be referred to as something I'm not. But I'm a person, and chairs don't come into it when it comes to that. We're talking firefighters, so let's have chair, for goodness sake.
Thank you, Councillor Brown.
Okay. Good. Yeah, so thanks. I mean, I think I've obviously said my piece on this. So I'm going to move the recommendation separately, obviously, given comments. So I'm going to move 2.1, which is to approve the amended standing orders. And as Councillor Hennie Simons said, a lot of work has gone into this, I think, to actually update our system and make it more efficient. And also bring it in line with other fire authorities, other local authority models. So can I have all those in favour of the approving the amended standing orders appendix A? Are you going to count them, please? Or do we don't? Okay, all those against? And abstentions.
Oh, this is for the second one, is it?
No, it's the first. Standing order. Good one. There's two abstentions.
Carried.
That's carried. Thank you. Thank you, members. And 2.2 is to approve all references to chairman and vice chairman to be changed to chair and vice chair in all documents and members' handbook. But all those in favour of 2.2 recommendation? All those against? Sorry. Okay, thank you. Carried. Thank you, members. Okay, we moving on to agenda item 12, which is the Fire Authority Firefighters Pension Scheme Administration Management and Governance Strategy. Pages 149 to 178. Becky, we love a pension item.
Good, thank you. I've got two tonight. So this first item relates to, as I said, the administration, management and governance strategy for firefighter pension schemes. In 2018, the Firefighter Pension Scheme Advisory Board commissioned a benchmarking review. And one of the recommendations from that review was that the standards and expectations of fire and rescue authorities and pensions administrators in relation to firefighter pension schemes should be formalised. Officers have reviewed some of the template strategy documents that were presented out of that review. We've taken account of the existing arrangements, so those are things that would have been approved by the authority in the past. Contractual arrangements set out with pensions administrator and those service level agreements, together with statutory timescales and provisions as outlined in the strategy document itself. We've consulted with all the stakeholders relevant, so that would be our pensions payroll providers and also the local pensions board, before recommending to the Fire Authority that the administration management governance strategy set in Appendix A to the document is approved. And subject to that approval, the document would do be published. Happy to take any questions.
Any questions for? Rounds. This will be moved to the page side. Alboro, agenda pack here. I'm going to move this. Okay, yeah, no, it's fine. Well, I was going to say thanks very much for the work, because I know we might make light of this, but an immense amount of work goes into this, Becky. So thanks very much for that. I'm going to move this. This is 2.1, approve the RDFA Firefighters Pension Scheme. Sorry, Councillor, okay.
Sorry, Chair. I was.
Do you want to ask a question? Yes. Or do you want to comment?
No, I have a question.
No, fine. Good.
Yeah, excellent. The question is, I mean, thank you very much for the report. I'm just picking up again
on the quality, diversity and inclusion, and the statement that you made that there are no equality, diversity and inclusion implications arising from this report, 7.1. And I just wondered, what was the basis for making that statement?
So in relation to the provision of the strategy itself, it sets about formalising the structures, the expectations of the administrator and fire and rescue authorities in the management of pensions. There are elements, of course, like the next paper item on the agenda, where we look at discretions and how they operate within the pension scheme and how they apply to cases. However, in producing a strategy itself, it doesn't have any equality implications. It would be the application of, for example, discretions utilised within the pension scheme as provided, or how we might manage cases through that would have risk. And of course, in all of those cases, we would assess the impacts, and part of the provision of some of the items in the next agenda would enable us to adequately consider those matters as they apply to individuals on that case-by-case basis. So in relation to this report, in putting it into a strategy format, it doesn't have any equality, diversity or inclusion issues arising from that.
Good, thank you. Good, thanks. Any more questions?
Okay. I will move the recommendation in 2.1.
We've got a second. Councillor Brown.
Okay.
All those in favour of approving? Anybody against?
Okay, I think that's unanimous. It is unanimous. Thanks very much. I think we can move on to agenda item 13, which, as we've hinted at, is also pension related. It's discretion statements. I'm going to pass over to Becky again.
Thank you, and thanks for the link into this item. In terms of this particular item on pension scheme discretions, members are probably somewhat aware of the Pensions Ombudsman case concerning the abatement of a retired firefighter in another authority, which has been mentioned in some of the previous reports coming through. The Ombudsman's determination in that case was that the blanket application of a policy position could be potentially unfair. So to support effective governance, officers have conducted a review of the scheme manager discretions contained within the three firefighter pension schemes to change wording to enable individual cases to be considered on a case-by-case basis as appropriate. Perhaps just worth pointing out that whilst the 1992 and the 2006 schemes are closed schemes, some of those discretions can still be applied. For example, the abatement discretion when people may be re-employed. And hence we've provided new discretion statements to cover those two schemes. And in your paper pack, we've included a tracked version of the 2015 scheme, which shows that change of wording from wherever we might have a blanket policy to a case-by-case consideration. The local pensions board have been consulted on the discretion statements, which are now recommended to the fire authority for approval. Happy to take any questions.
Questions? Thank you. Councillor Brooks.
I note on page 181, financial implications, it's not possible to identify the financial implications, which is a worry in a way. Is there any way of assessing an average value of financial impact? Because when you go on to Appendix A, and I recognise that this is, we're just adapting that, the yellow highlights, this does exist now. But the scheme of delegation officers approved by the authority states that the chief fire officer is fully empowered to exercise the powers of the authority under the firefighter pension scheme. So if it were 150k, I'm sure it might be, the chief fire officer can simply push that, pass that through, and the budget lead and Connor would just be told. Now, I'm probably exaggerating the
sake of effect. But is there any way we could look at what this financial implication might be on a case by case, you know, average?
Probably not is the answer, because the range of circumstances, discretions that exist, and the factors that come into play in each of those individual cases can be very different. Members probably remember a paper not too long ago where one of the discretions had no financial impacts as a result of exercising that particular discretion, but in other cases there may be other, you know, considerable impacts. What I would say is that where we're aware of some of those things, like the remedy piece of work that's been undertaken and some of that yet to play through secondary legislation, we're committed to bringing updates to the authority about what those implications might be to the fire authority, and that because obviously they have fire reaching aims. But in terms of case by case, it depends on the nature of the discretion, the length of service, what the individual's position is. So it's very difficult to take an average, I think, or provide some response.
Then I would ask another question.
Of course, you can ask.
For the chief to give a bit of a heads up if there's a particularly expensive one or two coming into view, just for the sake of information and potential impact.
Yeah, absolutely. So I would not want to be in a position, regardless of the being fully empowered to exercise the powers of the authority in relation to pensions administration or scheme management, I think where there are reasonable or significant costs attached, it would be very prudent to keep members appraised through budget management or budget monitoring of such expenditure, so we would do that as a matter of course.
Thank you.
I've had some of those come before us. Councillor Brown.
Thank you, Chair. I was fascinated, I have to say, unfortunately, by some of the little details that have been clarified, and I think this can only help to resolve cases where otherwise it would take hours and hours and lots of different people involved. But if we've got this clarification, I think it will, I think, would it?
Yeah.
make the job easier if we've got this document.
Yes, to answer that question, yes. Combined with the previous item on the strategy of the discretions aids transparency and allows individuals to understand what they can expect from the employer and the administrator in relation to the management of their pensions. So, yes.
As any other members indicated, so I'm going to move this, which is 2.1 to 2.3 on pages 1791. Page, I'm going to take move this en masse. All in favour?
Second.
Who was the second? Sounds like you're better. Sorry. All those in favour? Unanimous. Thank you. Okay. So, agenda item 14 is the annual Treasury Management Review. Treasury Management Update, and that's Vern.
Thank you, Chair. So this item contains two Treasury Management reports. The first is the annual report for 21-22, and that's attached as Appendix A. And the second is the mid-year update for 22-23, and that's attached as Appendix B. Actual performance for both periods is in line with prudential indicators approved by the authority and when the budget is set for each of those periods. In line with the capital strategy as approved by the authority, borrowing increased in 21-22 for the first time since 2009-10. £5 million of new loans were taken out and £1.17 million was repaid during 21-22. The authority is due to repay a further £2 million in March 2023. borrowing at this time enabled the authority to take advantage of the historically low bank rate. Throughout 2022, the picture has changed considerably with the Monetary Policy Committee raising rates at its last 9 meetings. Bank rate was increased to 3.5% this month. And turning to income on invested monies, and the guidance on local government investments in England gives priority to security and liquidity, and the authority's aim is to achieve a yield commensurate with these principles. Therefore, the authority's investment strategy, as approved by members, is based on these principles, namely security of principle first and foremost, followed by liquidity of investment, and then yield and eventual return. The authority aims to achieve the optimum return on its investments, commensurate with proper levels of security and liquidity, and within the authority's risk appetite. In the current economic climate, it is considered appropriate to keep investment short-term to cover cash flow needs. Through close cash flow management, the authority has been able to capitalise on the increased rates available and to place a number of fixed-term deposits during 2022-23. Due to the high interest rates and the capital received from the sale of Deep Road, interest received in 2022-23 is estimated to be £300,000. I'm happy to take any questions.
Questions? Councillor Linden.
Thanks, Chair. I'd like to ask Connor, I know this is a bit of a crystal ball, but I know this is an investment strategy, but you also mentioned about income. How do you foresee things are going at the moment vis-a-vis the budget with all these increased costs that we're likely to be facing with the cost of living crisis and National Works loan draw, for instance, increasing rates and the rest of it?
Yes, in terms of pressures over the next year, indeed into my medium-term financial plan, and they are substantial and they are increasing, volatility is increasing, and we are working through that, looking at those issues in the budget working party, and our aim is to have a balanced budget bring to our authority in February. So we're working very hard to do that, looking at savings, invest to save schemes, we'll be bringing a new efficiency plan to that meeting. So we are working very hard to ensure that we're saving a balanced budget and looking forward to members in February.
Sure, can I just
yeah, of course.
I presume we're carrying on our lobbying, obviously we've done it with our MPs and with government as well. But do you think things are going in a positive direction, Chief?
Yes. Frankly, yes. That's where the settlement funding assessment was announced last week, which was probably or arguably in excess of what we expected with the inflationary increase to the revenue support grant. Obviously, that's mainly revenue budget. This Treasury management, is slightly different than that. But of course, the revenue budget gives us headroom, more financial flexibility against capital borrowing and investments, etc. But the settlement from the assessment was favourable compared to where it could have been.
Thank you, Chair.
Councillor Brooks.
Thank you. And since this is my brief, we have got a lot of in-year pressures. We reported to the last management committee that there's an 800k overspend potential at the moment, which we're trying to reduce. And the next year is challenging, the points you make. On Treasury, we're benefiting now. The world is going back to an interest rate regime that the banks have been trying to get us back to since 2008. And in fact, before 2008, they were never down at 0% or 0.5% or -% by banks. And as the banking world, the financial world, has got us back to 3.5, 4, 4.5, that's closer to inflation and closer to where probably the world should be. Unfortunately, it's coming and it's hurting people, but giving us a net gain because of the money we have on deposit. But one thing I can announce is that we will be recommending that the authority
consults on five panel for fire again. We will have the latitude to do that the second year running, should members so propose to take that. And as you all know, Councillor Linden and other members, that's £1 million to the good if we go for it, if the public support it, and if we put it in our budget. But it is, as the Chief was saying, quite very, very helpful in building our budget for next year. Thank you, Chair.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I really appreciate the amount from Councillor Brooks. And of course, I know that we have some desperate investments in ICT and to make ourselves even more efficient, Chair.
Councillor Billingworth.
Thank you, Chair. Councillor Brooks, thank you very much for that. Would there be, and we'll have to move fairly quickly on this, I presume, consultation-wise, when would you propose that we go public on that?
Yeah. Only in the new year, only through the management committee and straight up to consult. Well, yes, you're right, we've got to get a move on because of the budget demands. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Yeah. Councillor Brooks.
Thank you, Chair. Apologies if it sounds like a silly question, but your investments total 7.4 million and very little returns, and then you borrow 5 million with a higher interest rate. I didn't understand the rationale behind that. Perhaps it's an investment policy approach or what? Because you talked also about trying to keep money short term. So given that the borrowing requirement is below what you have, that is not doing much, I mean, how did you weigh that up?
Yeah, so in terms of kind of Treasury policy, it's primarily looking to make sure that we have enough cash to meet both our revenue and our capital plans. And so over the last few years, we have spent considerable amounts on capital, hence the need to borrow. So in terms of borrowing, and borrowing is only done for capital. And in terms of how much we decide to borrow is based on capital financial requirement, which in a sense is based on our capital expenditure program. So that's the purpose of the borrowing. Borrowing is long term and is used to finance the capital program. So the investments are in many ways short term, but a slightly different position now since the sale of DLO prior to that, in short term investments to make sure that we can meet the cash flow requirements of the revenue budget. So the revenue budget is funded through council tax receipts and business rates grants. They come in different times of the year. We need to manage that, so that's the expense. So there is that distinction between borrowing for capital and then the cash flow need to be purchased as well as we balance for the
budget. Questions? Oh, Councillor Smith, sorry.
Thank you, Chair. The Chancellor recently announced for local authorities an increase in the cap with regard to what they could do in raising council tax, and that being 4.99% inclusive of a 1% pre-sup on adult social cap. Could the finance tell us what that means in terms of the cap for this authority? And secondly, if we are considering, or going to consider again, the possibility of another request for a fiver for fire, what does, remind us what a fiver translates into in terms of percentage increase?
The questions for you there, Paul.
Yeah, so in terms of that percentage increase for fiver, that's 6.8%. So previously, we were capped at 2.99%, but then we've had a notification from the government that the fire sector or fire and rescue services will be able to increase their preset by £5 of the current year. It was just those on the support arm that
Okay. So there's questions. I don't really want to, we asked to note the two.
Professor said proposal.
Yeah, I just said, do you want to put, Jeff, you want to leave, do you propose?
Proposal that this is noted to.
Yes. Do anybody want to second this noting? Councillor Sherwood Dupain. Okay, do we want to speak to this? We've got questions. There's much going to be elucidating, comprehensive. So I'm going to move those two notes. Everybody in favour, 2.1, 2.2? Right.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. Thanks for that. Moving on to agenda item 15. This is which is the forward plan. With the forward plan, all those,
yeah.
All those in favour of the forward plan? Thank you. Thanks very much. Glasses on there. Sorry, and then we've got the minutes of the standing committees. We note, we're asked to note those. He's happy to note them.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Thank you, Graham. And the date of the next meeting, item 17, is the Wednesday, the 15th of February. It's an interesting call. So, settle with that. And item 18, this is where we exclude the public and if there's any media before we move into part two. So, we ask the public and the press exit before we go on to the part two of the meetings. Anybody needs to exit?